November 1940. The Blitz had begun. Bombing from the air was still a new and terrifying phenomenon. No British city had been systematically destroyed until the 14th of November. In the biggest raid to date, 500 Nazi planes attacked Coventry, deep in the heart of England. Devastating bombs were dropped on innocent families.
We were all cowering on the floor and screaming. Just sheer terror. Just sheer terror.
The British government feared that intense bombing could cause the psychological collapse of the entire population. Those fears would now be tested, as never before.
And you stood there petrified as these huge explosions were coming towards you, and you felt so totally helpless.
It was a crucial moment in the war. Churchill awaited the outcome anxiously. Would the morale of the people crumble as their city collapsed?
The first reaction was there was shock. And then the second reaction was, we're not going to let the buggers get away with it, you know?
What happened after the bombing would astonish everyone. It would reveal both the terror of modern war and the extraordinary resilience of the British people.
I remember every cobble, every paving stone, the places where when the wind used to blow, perhaps an empty fag packet would be in a corner. It was a lovely old-fashioned town. The houses and shops are ever so old. And the cathedral, the bells used to ring, and every third hour, it used to play a hymn, Rock of Ages, or that sort of thing. You didn't have to count the bell as it went. You knew by the hymn it was playing what time it was.
The Cathedral of St. Michael had dominated the skyline of Coventry for half a millennium. But in the 20th century, medieval streets had been transformed. Coventry became an engineering and manufacturing centre. People from across Britain migrated to the city in search of work and a better life.
We came down from Barrow-in-Furness in Lancashire, and we lived in terraced houses with backyards. And we came down to Coventry, and there we had a front garden and a back garden, and everything seemed to be so spacious. We thought, what a nice, open, green place it was.
Everybody sort of knew everybody. Everybody did the same sort of things. You know, you went to Sunday school on a Sunday, and you went to the pictures, Tuppence Halfpenny, on the Saturday morning, the Tuppenny Rush. We were all the same, and there was a real camaraderie.
This is the national programme from London. Germany has invaded Poland and has bombed many towns. General mobilization has been ordered in Britain.
The following advice is given: to keep off the streets as much as possible. To carry a gas mask always.
With the outbreak of hostilities, Coventry factories became crucial to the war effort.
I worked at the Standard Motor Company. Places like the Alvis, and we're making armoured cars. Standard making aero engines. Route Security is making aircraft parts. There's an awful lot of innovation and inventiveness and sheer hard work going on in Coventry at that time.
Coventry was an obvious target. After a series of reconnaissance missions, the Luftwaffe had built up an intimate picture of the city. Coventry turned out hundreds of planes a year, but was very vulnerable to aerial attack.
There wasn't anything particularly unusual in that because Britain's anti-aircraft defences were pretty poor. There were something like 36 anti-aircraft guns and 56 or so barrage balloons. The RAF had not developed onboard radar to the degree where it could successfully intercept and then destroy a bomber operating at night time. So it was pretty thinly defended.
Factories and houses sat cheek by jowl. Heavy bombing of military targets would obliterate homes and lives throughout the city.
The Battle of France is over. The Battle of Britain is about to begin. Upon this battle depends the survival of Christian civilization.
This is a time when everything's bleak. France has fallen, Europe's fallen. We've come back from Dunkirk with nothing apart from the clothes we stand in. And it must be a very depressing time.
As a prelude to the invasion of Britain, the Nazis decided to soften up the civilian population. Past masters at terror bombing, the Germans knew that aerial bombardment could break a country's will to resist.
The theory was from Hitler, well, you know, we'll just carry on knocking here, knocking there, and perhaps these guys will come to their senses and realize they can't win. There's no Americans to help us, the Russians are on Hitler's side. It must have been looked very, very bleak.
This was the scenario the British government had long dreaded. The bombing of men, women and children in their own homes was a new and terrifying phenomenon. No one knew how civilians would react to the threat of death from the skies. Government psychiatrists had estimated that if Britain was blitzed, up to 4 million civilians would suffer intense psychological trauma. Acute panic, hysteria, and neurosis would set in. Adults would regress to infantile forms of behavior.
The authorities tended to have quite a low regard for ordinary people's ability to withstand both the physical and the psychological pressures of bombing. And the projections they made spoke of mass psychosis, of people flooding out of cities, of anarchy breaking out, of looting. They foresaw almost a collective nervous breakdown taking place.
The Blitz began with a series of heavy but scattered raids on London. Within weeks, other major cities and coastal towns were hit. In Coventry, the bombing was regarded with curiosity rather than concern.
There had been raids in the Midlands at Leicester and Birmingham, and in Coventry, they said, they can't find Coventry because we're in a hollow. And there's a mist in the hollow, and they said, they can't find Coventry.
Morale held up. But so far, no city had been carpet bombed for any length of time. Ordinary people were still unaware of the scale of devastation the Nazis could unleash. Then, out of the blue, British intelligence intercepted plans for the biggest attack to date. But no one could be sure of the target. The raid would take place during the night of the next full moon on November the 14th. And was codenamed Moonlight Sonata. The Prime Minister, Winston Churchill, believed that London was the target for the German attack.
He thought it was going to be a heavy raid, his secretaries were moved out, his staff were told to get out of London. But he, Churchill, would stay in London that night as Prime Minister to be part of what perceived to be this heavy bombing.
Only by mid-afternoon on the 14th of November did British intelligence finally identify the real target. An apocalypse was heading to Coventry. Britain's survival and the war's outcome could rest on the unfolding of the next few hours.
It's quite easy for me to remember that day, actually. I had a dental appointment in the afternoon, and so my mother took me to Golson Road Clinic, which is quite near the city centre. When we actually got home to the farm, it was already beginning to get dark.
9-year-old Valerie Good, her father, mother and younger sister were staying with friends, the Meikles, at a farm 3 miles from the city centre.
By now, the moon had come out, and it was really a very cold night. It was a full, bright, clear moon. So it seemed almost like daylight when you looked out of the doorway. It was a bit sort of almost scary in a way because of it being so bright.
The sirens pervaded the whole atmosphere all over the city. You could hear the sirens echoing off walls. And it makes my hair rise on the back of my neck whenever I hear that sound, because you know that what it means is danger.
16-year-old Alan Hartley was a factory worker by day and an air raid messenger by night.
I reported to our ARP post, which is number 607 in Greyswood Avenue. We're on the west side of Coventry, and we could hear these aircraft coming in from the east. And you could hear the distinctive note of the German bombers, like a throb of the diesel engines.
When the sirens went, I was having a wash, a good wash, because they'd all gone over to the shelter, which meant I was in the room on my own and I could do it better. And then halfway through it, the man next door hammered on the wall. They're over. What else do you think? I knew they were over.
Joan Beckett was 20. She worked in a factory and lived with her parents in Spawn Street, a medieval lane west of the city centre.
I got dressed and I opened the door. I ran down the entry and looked across at the shelter, and I could hear the man at the top of the shelter say, "Come on, run for it, missus, run for it."
Suddenly, to my right, I saw this parachute flare, and then I went a little bit left, another parachute flare, and then another one, and then another one, and as I turned around, I was following these parachute flares breaking out and lighting, until eventually there's a whole ring of parachute flares around Coventry.
The flares marked out targets for the first wave of German bombers. The attack began with the dropping of thousands of incendiary bombs to set the city alight. Valerie Good and her family had taken refuge in the cellar.
Opposite the farm where we were, there was another farm, and there the RAF had taken it over, and they had a barrage balloon. There was one man on duty. We could hear two girls, and this airman, they were busy laughing and talking, and it came over very clearly. Suddenly, the two girls who'd been busy laughing and talking, we heard them screaming and running down the lane. Mr. Meikle, the farmer, and my dad went out to see what had happened. They actually carried the airmen into the farm kitchen.
Incendiary bombs were familiar. But this time, the Germans had booby-trapped them. Anyone caught in the blast was showered with white-hot shards of metal.
Mr. Meikle was on the phone, and he was trying to get through to the hospital for them to send an ambulance out. He tried and tried, and nothing happened. Soon after that, the local policeman came just to see if everything was all right at the farm. He said he would try and get a message through to the hospital.
More than 200 fires were burning across the city, but this was only the beginning. High explosive bombs fell next, flattening buildings, cratering roads, and severing telephone wires, cutting off the city.
And you could hear the bombs muffled to begin with, but as they came closer, they came louder and louder and louder. And you stood there petrified as these huge explosions were coming towards you, and you felt so totally helpless. There's nothing you could do. Where could you run to? The way these were coming in long sticks of bombs, portended something really terrible that was going to happen.
Fear was taking hold in Coventry, just as the government had predicted.
We had no air raid shelter, simply because the Anderson shelters wouldn't have taken a family of our size.
Eileen Bees was 9 years old. She was with her 11 brothers and sisters in the family home in Clay Lane.
We all went into the front room, and we were sitting on the three-piece suite that was in there, when suddenly we had a bomb fall at the front of the house, which brought the window in. And as the glass all came in, it all came across my back. And we were all cowering on the floor and screaming. And my sister was absolutely hysterical. Totally hysterical. But the house next door to us, they took Irish lodgers. And they heard us all screaming. So they got us all out and decided that we'd got to go round to the local shelter. As we ran, I can remember the glass crunching under my feet. And I can remember how red the sky was. It was bright, bright red. The searchlights were all over. It masses of searchlights.
In the sky in front of you, you've got these huge searchlights. And just occasionally, you would see a little blob of silver in the searchlight where they'd picked up an aircraft just momentarily. And it looked like a moth in the candle flame. And all the anti-aircraft guns would center onto that particular area. And then the moth would dive out and disappear. And then they go around the sky looking for it again. But very dramatic to see the people who were killing you and dropping the bombs lit up in a searchlight.
Many families had taken refuge in Anderson shelters, corrugated iron sheets sunk into back gardens. 9-year-old Eric Holt was with his brothers, his sister and his mother.
There were four bunks, and my mum sat at the entrance. My dad was on watch in the street, and he kept popping back to see we were okay. He'd got us out to look at some tracer firing up at the aircraft, and we watched these for a while. They were like fireworks lancing up into the sky. I remember that very clearly. And then we settled back into our bunks. And my dad was crouched in the entrance talking to us. This landmine came down between our two houses. But my dad, being so close, saw it. He settled back into the entrance and faced inwards. He set his back against the blast to protect us as much as he could. There's absolutely no impression of sound. And then, like a huge cushion, pressed down, held down, and blackness and silence.
Alwyn Sweetman was a 24-year-old policeman. He was on duty in Spond Street near the city centre when an explosion shattered nearby buildings.
The blast blew the top of the police box off, and I felt the blast thumping on my chest. The door flew open, looked across the road, and the pub that was there had been blown down. First thing I did was to leave the box and then go straight over to see what was happening. And there were people there. Some were covered up by bricks, screaming, some of them shouting, "Get me out." A woman was sobbing, crying, long grey hair she got. She was buried up to chest height. Her arms were free above the bricks, and she was moving one or two bricks as best she could. She was trying to get herself out. She couldn't talk, I don't think. So she'd be too upset herself or too shocked to talk. Some of the men were crying as well. Wasn't far off it myself sometimes. That's how I felt. But it was my job to hide my feelings from other people so they could tell I was a good constable, could be depended upon.
The Germans would fly and bomb in a straight line. And then when they'd done all the straight lines east to west, they then started from the other side of Coventry and did the same thing, lines, like darning a sock.
It had been a meticulously planned and perfectly executed raid.
What they managed to do was focus a whole bomber fleet of over 400 bombers onto one relatively small central English town. That was unique. It was one of those perfect storm situations. The weather was clear, the bombs all went down properly on spec, and that's why you had the destruction you did.
The Luftwaffe even had time to film the mission. This rare footage shows how Coventry was incinerated street by street. Almost all the telephone wires were down, but word made it through to the Prime Minister about the level of devastation. Churchill knew what was at stake. He telephoned those responsible for the defence of the city and demanded they fight back. But anti-aircraft defences were overwhelmed by the intensity of the attack. Thousands of rounds were fired, but no German bombers were shot down over Coventry.
Everybody knew it was a lot different because the girders were all shaking, the dust was coming down, and you could hear the thuds, you know, closing in. And one after, it was like rain coming down. You talked, and some tried to crack jokes, some of them were crying, some of them got things in their ears so they couldn't hear them.
The children would get, you know, fretful, you know, crying and so on. because it's just a terrifying feeling being in a hole in the ground while somebody's pelting you with bombs. I was sort of up a corner with a candle trying to do some homework. Mum was trying to get the boys to sleep, but who could sleep through that? And of course, as the night wore on, the atmosphere got terrible because people smoked in those days. So the atmosphere got really foggy, and of course, they just had buckets for the latrines behind a sort of a curtain. And with 300 people and the effect that fright has on some people, you know, it got really smelly.
After hours of intense bombing, morale was beginning to break down.
There was quite a bit of anger at times, I remember, where a lot of arguing went on. They were arguing about, well, it sounded silly things to me, like, for instance, how many bombs they'd heard come down and things like that. One would say, oh, that was 10, and somebody'd say, oh, no, it wasn't, it was only 9.
I couldn't sit there. I used to go to the doorway of the shelter and look out into Spon Street. I could see Freddie Evans. He had a furniture shop, and on the other side of the road, he had a pawn shop. And they must have both caught fire at the same time. And as I looked like that up the street, you could see the flames meeting over the top. It's furniture shop, his pawn shop, in a big arc.
High explosives had shattered the water mains. Firefighters were powerless to control the flames.
I think one of the most pathetic memories I have would be seeing this fireman there with his yellow oil skins. His face was blackened with smoke and the eyes were red-rimmed. He looked so so pathetic and helpless because he was holding a hose pipe where there's no water coming out of the hose pipe, just a trickle of water coming out of the hose pipe.
The German air crews were bombing to a carefully worked out plan designed to cause maximum devastation.
You want to destroy water pipes so that the fire engines can't get through. You want to destroy the fire stations. You want to destroy the electricity supplies. You want to destroy everything that will stop the defenders defending and putting the fire out. What you want is the town to destroy itself.
A firestorm was devouring the city. By late evening, a message was sent out. Fire position serious. In the medieval heart of Coventry, the city's 500-year-old cathedral was being incinerated. Valerie Good and her family were still in the farm cellar when, several hours after his first visit, the local constable returned.
I can remember seeing his face, how he'd changed so differently from when he came the first time. It'd become somehow greyer in his features, and you could sort of see the strain of what he'd seen and had to cope with in the few hours that he'd been away. I can remember him saying that the city was totally devastated. It was all on fire. And even the cathedral had been bombed. And my mum said, she thought that was the worst thing out. She said, oh, not the cathedral.
Hours after his family's Anderson shelter had been blasted by a landmine, Eric Holt was still trapped in the wreckage.
I came round and they were straining to force the shelter apart. It obviously somehow cut off the bolts. Then they had to force the thing open. And when they opened it at last and the night air rushed in, I rolled out onto the curb of the shelter. Then one of them picked me up and took me to an ARP station, which was up further up the road. I didn't see my family, I didn't see anything at that point. You just didn't know where your family were.
Thousands of people had been separated from their loved ones in the chaos which was now overwhelming the city.
I got called to a house, and this was a little away from my police box. So when I got there, a woman was sobbing, crying, in the entrance at the side of the house. She said, "I can't see my husband. I know he's at the bottom of the garden somewhere. I can't see him." I went with her straight away, so I said, "It's all right, I'll find him. Come with me, we'll find him." And at the bottom of the garden was an entry between the garden and the factory. And surely enough, just a little a yard away from her garden gate, was a pile of bricks with a head poking out of the top. It was her husband's head. Then I got the bricks away as quickly as I could, and I could see his shoulders sticking up, almost down to his waist. So I got my hands under his shoulders, started to pull him out. I thought, well, he's bound to come soon. But the top half of his body came, left the bottom half still buried under the bricks. I said, "You go down, make yourself a cup of tea. I'll come in a minute." She did go back in the house, crying her heart out, of course. That upset me quite a lot. And I hadn't seen anything as bad as that before. And when I got out, I just lay down, face down in the gutter, head down in my arms. And I remember, "God, don't let it be me."
More than 6 hours after the raid began, the attack reached a climax. Flames from the burning city could be seen from the Channel coast more than 100 miles away. Coventry was clearly visible for the next wave of German bombers.
It just felt all knotted somehow inside. Just hoping that the next one that you heard wasn't going to blast the farmhouse to pieces. Then there was the most horrendous bang of the night. We really thought we'd had it that time. I don't know whether it's a fear. It's just, or a feeling that's inside, which is almost indescribable because of literally what we'd gone through. It was just indescribable. Oh God. The fear of that night. Oh For a moment, I was really back in that cellar. But then, of course, we were the lucky ones. We were the lucky ones. We had survived.
...500 tons of high explosive and 30,000 incendiaries had fallen on Coventry. It had been the most concentrated blitz on any British city so far. After 13 hours spent underground, the people of Coventry emerged to a city transformed.
It was cold, it was a damp, dreary morning. The streets, I remember, were absolutely running with water, with broken water mains. There was people walking about, looking absolutely shell-shocked, didn't know where they were going.
You couldn't believe that this had happened. I mean, one minute you've got a prosperous, lively town with people just going about their normal business, and the next you've got nothing. Just destruction. You know, people dead and homes, businesses gone, fires.
There was horrible smells. You couldn't tell what it is. Some of it smelled a bit like meat cooking.
And they'd laid out, you know, people they'd found covered up with blankets. Just shapes, you know, just covered with army blankets.
The respected research organisation, Mass Observation, arrived in Coventry a few hours after the all clear. They found a city suffering from a collective nervous breakdown.
Women were seen to cry, to scream, to tremble all over, to faint in the street, to attack a fireman. The tremendous impact of the previous night had left people practically speechless in many cases. The dislocation is so total in the town that people feel that the town itself is killed.
Morale was collapsing, just as the government had feared. All sense of normality had been buried beneath the wreckage of the city. Familiar landmarks which had stood for half a millennium had vanished in a single night.
We stood and watched the cathedral. Couldn't believe it had gone. You could feel the heat before you got to it. The sandstone seemed to hold the heat. It was red. It wasn't red with the flame. It was red because it was red hot.
You see all the destruction that's been caused in the middle of Coventry, and you think, who the devil's going to sort this lot out? You know, who's going to get life flowing again in Coventry? What's going to happen? Not only tomorrow, but the day after, and the day after, and the day after. What's going to happen to Coventry? I couldn't see Phoenix rising from the ashes at that time. All I could see was the ashes.
The scale of the destruction was awesome. Three quarters of all the buildings in the city centre had been obliterated. A third of Coventry factories, vital to the war effort, had been flattened. More than half of all homes had been destroyed. Much of the city was without gas and electricity. Tens of thousands were without water or food.
Dad went to the local cooked meat shop, which was just round the corner from where we were in the shelter, to see if they could give us some food. There was no one there. So he forced his way into the back of the shop and he got us something to eat, and it was cold faggots. And we sat and ate those cold faggots while the people were not there. And while we were eating those, they came back, and Mr. and Mrs. Darby were shocked, obviously, to see us in their house because Dad had broken in. And he wouldn't have done that normally. He would never have taken anything.
Sheer desperation was threatening a breakdown of law and order. The prospect of anarchy horrified the government. The Home Secretary, Herbert Morrison, hurried to Coventry with cabinet colleagues.
What they saw dismayed them, particularly Morrison, who detected, as he wrote in his diary, that there were signs of defeatism. He was unimpressed by the demeanour of the officials. I think his response was very unfair. These men had been up all night trying to defend their city. They were exhausted. Indeed, the chief of the fire service, who arrived covered in grime and dirt from the smoke, fell off to sleep during the meeting. But it was an indication of alarm in high circles about whether indeed Britain could take it.
By late afternoon, rumours spread that more German bombers were on their way. 100,000 people, half the city's population, fled in panic. Hilda Marchant was a battle-hardened war reporter for the Daily Express. She described the mass exodus.
It was a familiar sight, one I had seen in Spain and Finland. Yet this was worse. These people moved against a background of suburban villas, had English faces, used the English tongue, wore English clothes. They were our own kind.
There were hundreds of people walking, not only us. They'd got babies in prams. We had a baby in the pram. They were carrying things that they could manage. They were crying. There was a lot of crying. Just total despair, really.
Coventry was absolutely essential to keep the war production going, to keep the munitions factories, the armaments factories churning out the weapons that were needed to win the war. If the people of Coventry, if the factory workers were going to run away after such a bombardment, then this posed very, very serious questions about whether the war could actually be maintained.
Tom Harrison was the director of mass observation. In a broadcast for the BBC, he described the despair he'd encountered in Coventry.
I spend a good deal of life listening to other people talk, but I've never heard people talk less than in Coventry yesterday. As soon as darkness fell, the streets were silent. The people of Coventry had gone to shelter. I think this is one of the weirdest experiences in my whole life. Driving in a lonely, silent desolation and drizzling rain in that great industrial town.
Harrison's report sparked fury in the cabinet. Coventry's morale was in freefall, and now, through the airwaves, it threatened to infect the nation at large. Concern was so great that the government even contemplated taking over the BBC. the greatest threat to the independence of the broadcaster during the whole of the war.
I want to remind you about how very important it is that all water shall be boiled before being used in Coventry.
On Saturday morning, my father and my older sister went into town. They were rather a long time coming back. And so my mother was getting anxious, of course. When they came in, all they said was, "We saw the king! We saw the king!"
The king has been to see how the people of Coventry were carrying on after their terrible ordeal. This was the cathedral. The city, having been mercilessly bombed throughout a whole night without regard to military targets, now presents a grim appearance of devastation.
I can remember Dad saying that he'd been asked to step aside, my man, for your king. And Dad couldn't believe it because he could have touched him. He said that he never imagined that he could ever in his life be so close to him. And it really gave him a lift. It made everybody proud of the fact that he'd taken time out to come and visit us, a very humble city in a way.
The king's visit was a rare morale boost during days of despair.
On the highest prominence of the cemetery of Coventry, 172 murdered people are laid to rest. As family mourners file to the one great grave and bow their heads in prayer, Coventry mourns.
6 days after the attack, Coventry held the first of two mass burials.
How shall we rank thee upon glory's page, but by the name of martyr?
Nine-year-old Eric Holt was still in hospital. He was recovering from the explosion that had destroyed his family's Anderson shelter when he heard that his father had been killed.
The nurses were so kind and trying to be comforting. And people do the best for you all the time. But you don't really, I think, appreciate it. And it's a shame. Sometimes you feel you'd like to go back. Just to say thank you.
Eric still didn't know if his mother, brothers and younger sister had survived.
This strange lady came down the ward being supported by a nurse. I was really worried. And when she stayed and came to my bed and approached me, that it was quite frightening, really. And it was my mother, and I did not recognise her until she spoke. Left side of her face was burnt. She'd lost her eye. Her wrist was broken. She was burnt down her left side, ankle broken. Just threw her arms around me, and like a reunion.
Nearly 2 months after the Blitz, Eric was finally reunited with his brothers and his sister.
The Food Flying Squad is on the road to Coventry after the recent heavy raids on that gallant city. The mobile canteens race to the scene of devastation to relieve the distress of those who have lost their home.
In the wake of the bombing, a huge relief operation was launched. Shelter was provided for the homeless. 20,000 meals were served every day. Builders were drafted in to patch up homes. Electricity, gas, and water supplies were restored. As physical reminders of the bombing were cleared away, the spirit of the people of Coventry began to change.
I think the first reaction was there was shock. And then the second reaction was, you know, pardon my French, but we're not going to let the buggers get away with it, you know? We'll be going to fight back.
Within weeks, Coventry factories had recovered. In time, they quadrupled their pre-Blitz output.
Absolutely fantastic, the speed that they recovered. Although the workers weren't in the front line, they were going to give every support they could to the people who were in the front line. I've seen people, when the air raid warnings had gone in the factories, working on their machines with the tin hats on their heads.
The town itself just came up like a phoenix and got on with its life, and the war machine that came out of there and the people's resolve was more dedicated, more powerful than before. So from a military point of view and a strategic town point of view, I think Coventry probably came out with fire in its belly to an extent it didn't have before.
The government had feared that the bombing of Coventry would lead to mass panic and hysteria. This could corrode morale and sap the will to fight. But contrary to expectations, an attitude not of defeat, but of defiance, had taken hold. And when evacuation places were offered to 10,000 people, only 300 chose to leave. Only months after the Coventry Blitz, the Prime Minister praised the resilience of the British people.
When, after the enemy wearied of his attack on the capital and turned to other parts of the country, many of us, in our hearts, felt anxiety. However, the staunchness and vigour of London was fully matched by the splendid behaviour of our ports and cities, when they in turn received the full violence of the enemy's assault.
In the inferno of Coventry and other cities, the Blitz spirit had been forged.
Coventry just reinforced that view, that even when that disaster had really been concentrated in a relatively small town, and really a whole community had been shattered, again that whole community had stood up alongside London, Plymouth and everybody else, and said yet again, it doesn't matter what you do, the bombing will not destroy us. The British morale, if anything, improved. It became more dogged, more bulldoggish, more, we're not going to let them beat us.
500,000 kilogram bomben wurden in einer einzigen Nacht über Coventry abgeworfen.
In the immediate aftermath of the bombing, jubilant Nazis had coined a term to describe the laying waste of a town by air attack, to Coventrate. But the propaganda backfired. The Coventry Blitz became a symbol of Nazi ruthlessness.
It showed that there was going to be no mercy in this war, and that it would be foolish to show any mercy to the people who had perpetrated the attack. So any scruples that people might have had about the conduct of the war, the way the war should be fought henceforth, were eradicated by Coventry. When British bombers started going to Germany and laying waste to cities, very, very few people were opposed to that. When later the bomber crews flying those aeroplanes were asked what was your justification for this, they had a one-word answer, Coventry.
RAF Bomber Command studied and perfected the technique of Coventration. The total war the Nazis inflicted on Coventry was revisited to even more devastating effect on German cities.
The Royal Air Force learned from Coventry how to Coventrate night after night after night. Remember that towards the end of the war, Royal Air Force is dropping every night three times the bomb load that was dropped on Coventry, night after night after night. And in the daylight, the United States Air Force was dropping the same three or four times, day after day after day.
568 people died in the bombing of Coventry. 35,000 were killed in Dresden, 50,000 in Hamburg. Coventry's resurrection had proved the doommongers wrong. But the city that emerged from the ashes was utterly changed.
It was almost impossible to think that this had happened to our city. And everything had changed, literally overnight.
It still comes into my mind without me thinking about it. These days, still comes into my mind.
I think it was about 1999 when I put it down on paper. And I cried for the whole time that I did it, that I wrote it.
I had an enormous hatred for the Germans. They were the enemy. And it wasn't till many years later, my oldest son had to go to Germany on some work they were doing. And he came back and he said, "They're not so bad, you know, Dad. They're very friendly and hospitable, very kind." It wasn't till then the feelings began to leave of this hatred, because it had disrupted our lives. It's personal, isn't it? They personally damaged you. You just have to let go. It's past.